We're on module 5. I'm going to be recording the lecture today. Matteo is out. We might have some others out, so we'll see. Okay, we're going to be moving on from bones to muscles. So we'll be looking at, I think we'd spend maybe 2 modules on muscles. Today we're talking about basically the microanatomy and physiology. Next time we'll be talking about the actual muscles, so the anatomy of the names of muscles and things like that. All right, so we're going to start off with a little intro. Before we start, I did bring the bones back, the bones that were in the vinegar. So I'm going to show it to you.
How long are they in the
vinegar? So it would have been 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So I have to pour out the vinegar. And then you'll see the bone is very bendy. See how it's bending? Okay. So that's what the vinegar did to it. It took out the strength, and now my hands are vinegary bone. Okay, we're going to start off today learning about muscles with a video.
Each time you take a step, 200 muscles work in unison to lift your foot, propel it forward, and set it down. It's just one of the many thousands of tasks performed by the muscular system. This network of over 650 muscles covers the body and is the reason we can blink, smile, run, jump, and stand upright. It's even responsible for the heart's dependable thump. First, what exactly is the muscular system? It's made up of 3 main muscle types: skeletal muscle, which attaches via tendons to our bones; cardiac muscle, which is only found in the heart; and smooth muscle, which lines the blood vessels and certain organs like the intestine and uterus. All 3 types are made up of muscle cells, also known as fibers, bundled tightly together. These bundles receive signals from the nervous system that contract the fibers, which in turn generates force and motion. This produces almost all the movements we make. Some of the only parts of the body whose motions aren't governed by the muscular system are sperm cells, the hair-like cilia in our airways, and certain white blood cells. Muscle contraction can be split into 3 main types. The first 2, shortening muscle fibers and lengthening them, generate opposing forces. So the biceps will shorten while the triceps will lengthen or relax, pulling up the arm and making it bend at the elbow. This allows us to, say, pick up a book, or if the muscle relationship is reversed, put it down. This complementary partnership exists throughout the muscular system. The third type of contraction creates a stabilizing force. In these cases, the muscle fibers don't change in length, but instead keep the muscles rigid. This allows us to grip a mug of coffee or lean against a wall. It also maintains our posture by holding us upright. Skeletal muscles form the bulk of the muscular system, make up about 30 to 40% of the body's weight, and generate most of its motion. Some muscles are familiar to us, like the pectorals and the biceps. Others may be less so, like the buccinator, a muscle that attaches your cheek to your teeth, or the body's tiniest skeletal muscle, a 1 millimeter long tissue fragment called the stapedius that's nestled deep inside the ear. Wherever they occur, skeletal muscles are connected to the somatic nervous system, which gives us almost complete control over their movements. This muscle group also contains 2 types of muscle fibers to refine our motions even further: slow twitch and fast twitch. Fast twitch fibers react instantly when triggered, but quickly use up their energy and tire out. Slow twitch fibers, on the other hand, are endurance cells. They react and use energy slowly so they can work for longer periods. A sprinter will accumulate more fast twitch muscles in her legs through continuous practice, enabling her to quickly, if briefly, pick up the pace. Whereas back muscles contain more slow twitch muscles to maintain your posture all day. Unlike the skeletal muscles, the body's cardiac and smooth muscles are managed by the autonomic nervous system, beyond our direct control. That makes your heart thump roughly 3 billion times over the course of your life, which supplies the body with blood and oxygen. Autonomic control also contracts and relaxes smooth muscle in a rhythmic cycle. That pumps blood through the smooth internal walls of blood vessels, enables the intestine to constrict and push food through the digestive system, and allows the uterus to contract when a person is giving birth. As muscles work, they also use energy and produce an important byproduct, heat. In fact, muscle provides about 85% of your warmth, which the heart and blood vessels then spread evenly across the body via the blood. Without that, we couldn't maintain the temperature necessary for our survival. The muscular system may be largely invisible to us, but it leaves its mark on almost everything we do, whether it's the blink of an eye or a race to the finish line. This video is made possible.
All right, so here we go on note-taking. We have four functional characteristics. I believe you have boxes, yes, at the top? Is it boxes? Yeah, this is. Okay, here we go. Number one, contractility. Now look at that word. It's not contractability, it's contractility. Where's your book?
I forgot it.
Do you want to make a copy?
It's fine.
Okay. So, contractility, the ability to forcefully shorten. The next one is excitability, the ability to be stimulated by nerves. They are innervated. We'll get to that at the end of the lecture. Extensibility, ability to stretch. And elasticity, the ability to snap back into shape. So I believe the boxes, you're just supposed to write down the big words, yeah? But you do need to know what the big words mean. So if you want to put a little note on there with it, that would be good. And then we have three basic tasks of your muscles. Movement, it's pretty obvious. Maintaining posture, which the video mentioned there. And heat production, also mentioned in the video. Okay, so those are the four functional characteristics and the three basic tasks. What we're looking right here on the right, it looks like a ham hock or something. Keep in mind, when you're eating a ham hock, you are eating the muscle of a pig. So when you're eating a red steak, you're eating a muscle of a cow. Okay, so, and I don't know about you, but I find muscles to be delicious. Okay, so we're going to actually end up kind of touching on these things as we proceed through here. Okay, so this is the basic information, and then we will kind of be using those words to talk about the way things function. So notice what he's doing, right? So he's got one of these elastic bands. So notice he's able to stretch it. What would that be? What of your list? Which one is that? There you go. And then this, going back. What's that? It goes back, not, you know, like I take this balloon and it goes back naturally, right? Our elasticity. One thing I can't make, I'm using a balloon. I could have used a rubber band. This guy's using one of those, whatever, the workout bands. If I could make it cinch up and get smaller. I can't do that with this, right? Because the balloon doesn't exhibit that contractility, which is to make it smaller. But that's the magic when it comes to muscles, is that contractility, the way it can shorten. All right, so let's talk about the muscle tissue itself. So we're looking at the microanatomy here, and we're going to see that muscle cells are like tiny motors because they have electricity coming to them, responsible for movement of bones and control of organs. Muscle tissue is highly vascular. What does that mean? Lots of blood supply to it. That's why red meat is red. Okay, it's blood. And then highly innervated. That's a new word, innervated. Do you hear the word nerve in there? That means they have electricity coming through them. Okay, so muscular tissue, I think we discussed that, how it's got the ability to be influenced by electricity. just like nervous tissue does, which we'll get to eventually, right? Three types of muscular tissue are, and these are going into your box, smooth, skeletal, and cardiac. So that one is skeletal. That's cardiac. There's smooth. All right. We will mostly be talking about skeletal tissue today, skeletal muscular tissue, and that's because the other two, smooth and cardiac, are highly specialized, and they fit better in other modules. For instance, cardiac tissue fits better in the module when we talk about the heart, right? Because that's where that muscle is. It's only found in the heart. Okay, and then our smooth muscle is pretty much all over the body. Any kind of, like our esophagus and our lungs and this kind of stuff have some smooth muscle in it. And in the video, you saw that it said it was part of the autonomic system, which you can think of, we'll get to that eventually, you can think of it as automatic. For instance, I can't just think about it and make my heart stop beating. Thank goodness, right? I can't do that. I can think about moving my arm, or jumping, or riding, or whatever. I can think about that, because those are voluntary muscles. The other ones, smooth and cardiac, are involuntary muscles. They're controlled by a different part of the nervous system. All right, so when we look at them under a microscope, these are drawings, of course, we're gonna see that skeletal muscle and smooth muscle, notice it's smooth because it doesn't have those little lines in it. So what happens here with the skeletal muscle, and it has these little lines all in it, these striations, these stripes, and it has to do with the way that all the little cells are lined up in there, okay? So we're gonna get to that. We're gonna see how they're in these little shapes there. And then we have in our cardiac muscle, we have these specialized little discs right in here that we'll get to when we talk about the heart. So if you're looking under a slide, you can pretty much tell the difference between smooth, skeletal, and cardiac just by looking at a microscope slide, because you can see some of those big differences. Notice how large nuclei are in that cardiac muscle right there. Cardiac muscle is so specialized that if you take some tissue off the heart itself, that little one cell you take off will be beating. That's how specialized cardiac tissue is. It beats on its own. Of course, it needs to have electrical impulses making your heart. Right now, your heart is beating because a signal is coming from your brain saying boom, 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 just like that. That is skeletal muscle. You can see all the striations in there. See lots of interesting nuclei along the sides there, making new stuff. All right, skeletal muscle is attached to bone by a tendon. Is that a blank to fill in?
It says skeletal muscle structure.
Okay, so yeah, that's interesting. I'm not sure why I'm talking about tendons right now. Yeah, in that skeletal muscle structure box, you're going to end up, I believe, drawing a picture. Okay? And this is the picture that, on a small side of it, I want you to draw this little thing on the left here. So it turns out that the cell is called a fiber. Okay? So the cell of skeletal muscle is a long cell like this. So remember when we drew just an animal cell, we would draw a circle with all this stuff on the inside? Well, that's not the shape of a skeletal muscle cell. It's the shape of a fiber. It's got a nucleus in it, of course, because it's telling it what to do. And, of course, it's going to have these little repeating units inside of it. And on the right here, the muscle fiber is what the fiber's made up of. All right, so it actually has these little compact units which are surrounded by connective tissue, surrounded by more connective tissue, surrounded by more connective tissue. But this is the fiber. You see the nucleus right there, the big purple nucleus. So I think, can you draw the, is this one better? Or the last one? You like that one? I think of it kind of like sushi. Now the sushi's wrapped up, you know, they got the thing inside the sushi. Right. So which one do you like better, that one or this one? Okay, so because the muscle fibers then, so this is a single fiber. Notice the small things in there. You take those fibers and put them together. Here it is. That thing right there is the fiber. I need you to understand that. But that's the fiber that has all this going on. And here we're going to put them together in this bundle right here called a fascicle. The whole thing is called a fascicle. When I just put a bunch of these guys together. Stacking them here. Something like that. And I'm going to put them all together, wrap them together into fascicles. But understand that the muscle fiber you're looking at right there, the little one coming out, is the actual cell. And inside the cell, there are more little tiny things called fibrils that are coming out of there. All right. Fibers are joined together by collagen fibers. They are wrapped by something called the endomycium, the perimycium, and the epimycium. You don't need to write that yet. You will in a minute. The endomycium extends past the epimycium, past the belly of the muscle, becomes dense irregular tissue, finally becoming a tendon. All right, so if I have my big giant muscle right here, we can see all that stuff right there, our little sushi. All right, so this outside tunic will eventually thin out, and that'll become a tendon. And you've seen tendons before, especially if you eat chicken. That little part on the end that's connected to the bone, if you've ever heard. When I was a kid, they didn't sell boneless, skinless chickens. They just sold whole chickens. We had to cut them ourselves and cut them off, the bone off of them. And it's not easy to do because they're attached to the bone very strongly with a tendon. And that tendon's that little very white shoelace-looking thing. If you're eating fried chicken, that's the thing you spit out. It's kind of hard. It's white because it doesn't have any blood supply. All right. So, but it's interesting that the connective tissue turns into that. Okay. So that's why it's so strongly attached. All right. How do we feel about our picture? Good. Got our little sushi roll going there. We'll see this again in other systems. In other words, a design like this is used over and over again by God, where he bundles things together to give them strength. We're going to see it specifically when we look at nerves. Nerves will also be bundled together like that. That makes that little tiny fibril inside the fiber stronger and stronger, like rope, right? A rope isn't just a single little piece, right? It's got a bunch, and they're all together, and they're twisted, and that's what this is going to be like. All those fibers coming together. All right, so now the connective tissue. This is the same picture, y'all, but just set up a different way right here. We see a blood vessel right there. So this you are writing down in a box. The connective tissue found in there, we're going to look at first at the epimycium. That's the outside layer. That's that layer, so the epi, that turns into a tendon eventually. It separates muscle from surrounding tissues and organs. We're going to find next time, our next module, in module 6, how we have those muscles wrapped in little membranes, and they form, that's how they are separated muscles. And then they'll sit next to each other as different muscles. The perimycium, you will see, is wrapping kind of this big part right here. So that would be this big circle right here, the peri. And then the endo, loose connective tissue that surrounds an individual muscle fiber. You see it in there, wrapped by perimycium, endomycium. It's just around that teeny tiny little dot coming out of there is going to be our endo. So remember, endo would be inside. So it goes endo, peri, epi. And then we have the blood vessel in there, very vascular. We have nerve cells in there as well. If you've ever cut yourself through the muscle, you know how painful it is. Even though it is painful to cut your skin, if you know you're down to the dermis when you do that, because the epidermis doesn't have any nerve endings in it. The dermis does. But if you have a deep enough cut that it goes into the muscle, it really hurts. That's because there's nerves in there. Sarcophagus. Mm-hmm. You know what it is?
Think of a mummy.
Mm-hmm. It's the box the mummy is in.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's a coffin. A coffin is called the sarcophagus. Phagus, phagus, means to eat. Sarco means meat. So a coffin eats meat. You're the meat. Yeah, a little bit. Nobody's taking Latin.
Mm-hmm.
because the word I'm talking about is called sarco. Sarco means meat. Okay, so sarco. And that's going to become important here in a minute. This was meat. All right, or flesh. So we're going to see now when we look at that cell, all right, everything that we, remember, just think about a cell. It has a nucleus, it has an endoplasmic reticulum, it has a ribosomes, it has mitochondria, it has Golgi bodies, the whole thing that we've always studied way back in the biology one. But when we're talking about muscle cells, we're going to have special names for them. For instance, the endoplasmic reticulum is going to be called the sarcoplasmic reticulum, which specifies it as muscular tissue. You get it? All right, so we're going to see our, that cytoplasm is called sarcoplasm. What else do we have? Sarcolemma, we'll get to that. Mitochondria is called mitochondria, sarcoplasm reticulum. Yeah, so we're going to see how this is. Here's our myofibril, which is one fiber with those repeating units that we're going to get to here in a second. Our sarcolemma is a surrounding it. Notice it has holes that are leading down to here. This allows there to be communication between the muscle fibers. Okay, and when I say fiber, that means muscle cell. Okay, all right, sarcoplasmic reticulum. And this T-tubule is also about communicating, and we call that thing a triad, where they're communicating through the T-tubule and the sarcolemma, right there. All right, but what we want to get to, what are those little repeating units that are inside that fiber? That's what gives them the stripes, okay? So we're going to see the stripes in there, and it's called a sarcomere. The plasma membrane is called the sarcolemma. That's just the membrane around it. The endoplasmic reticulum is known as the sarcoplasmic reticulum, containing those T-tubules, tiny tubules allowing the signals to communicate. Myofibrils are inside the fibers. And they occur in repeating units all the way down in the cell, creating those stripes. These units of repeating myofibrils are called sarcomeres. If you do not have a blank for sarcomere, make one. Sarcomere might be our most important word for today, because this is where the action happens. All right, well, you have myofibrils, you have that. Those are the thread light right here, right? You'll be writing that down. Okay, sarcomere is on page 38, the next page over. So I'll give you all a little bit to write all that down. Over on sarcomere, repeating units of myofibrils. Repeating units of myofibrils. So I'm going to erase this muscle thing here. And we're going to get into some of the physiology. And remember, when I say that, everybody should say, oh, not physiology. Remember, the anatomy is the easy part of this course. The physiology is the tougher part. That's because there are cascades of biochemical events that have to take place in order for this action to happen. If we miss one step along the way, you will not be contracting a muscle. And that would be bad, especially in your heart. If you don't contract that muscle, you're dead. All right, do we have those blanks filled in? On the second page, we have that for sarcomere. Do you all find that? Put a star by that one, by the way. I'm going to tell you what the sarcomere is, the functional unit. That's important. That's a question right there. What is the functional unit of the muscular system? Sarcomere. Because that's where the action is. That's where the stuff that's needs to happen. What do muscles need to do? They need to contract. They need to contract and then relax. Contract and relax. That's what your muscles are doing right now as you're writing. Your muscles are relaxing and contracting in a coordinated fashion, all done by your brain without you even thinking about it. Although you can stop. In other words, you can say, oh, I'm not going to write anymore. Right? So there are voluntary muscles, but there's so much action going on that you don't have to think about. Thank you, Lord, that I don't have to say, okay, hand contract, hand relax. I don't have to do that. It just does it, but it is voluntary. Okay, so here's our sarcomere, right? We have this repeating little line right here that looks a little bit like this and like this. Yikes. Okay, I'm going to have you draw something, but not this. Go draw. But I need you to show you that we have these things called the I band, the H band, the Z line, the M line, and the H zone. All right, so what's gonna happen is that these are gonna work by using energy to pull them inward. Okay, and that's called contraction. That's what the balloon, the rubber band can't do. I can't make it go and forcefully shorten. Contractility. All right, so the sarcomere is part of what is known as the sliding filament model. We're gonna watch a video, we're gonna watch some little animations, and you'll need to understand what's happening here. Okay, what we have in order for muscle contraction to take place is we have proteins working together. There are actually four proteins, two main ones called myosin and actin. The myosin has little grabby hooks on it called heads that reach in with the hook and pull the little muscle in. They literally pull it in, okay? And they pull the Z discs closer to the Z line here. Those will come closer together. This thing in the middle, which is the myosin, doesn't actually get any smaller. And neither does the actin. It doesn't actually get any smaller, but what it does, it pulls it over the top of it and makes the whole thing smaller. Do you get that? So those aren't actually getting smaller. They're just pulling it in. What can I relate that to? Kind of like sliding doors, right? The sliding door, when you slide a door in, you're not making the doors any smaller, but you're making it slide across the deal and open it up. You see, that's what's happening. They're on both sides. They're pulling that sliding door, and that's why it's called the sliding filament model. Keep in mind, this is a theory. We think this is what's happening. Science doesn't know for sure, but it's based on some really good data. All right, so the I band will shorten. That's just essentially between here, and it's just an area that gets smaller. The H zone will shorten here in the middle, but the actin and the myosin don't actually get shorter. That's the A band. It doesn't get any shorter. All right, let's watch a video and see if we can. And then I'll have you draw this. I have a better picture coming up after this for you to draw. Oh, wait, this is the picture I have. I want you to draw. Okay, this one up here. All right, so you're going to draw that middle part. I'll draw it too. Kind of like a long line, like this, with some little hooks on it. Hook, hook, hook.
Is this on skeletal muscle histology?
No, that's my experiment.
Yeah, that's an experiment.
Here you drew a line.
How muscle fibers contract. Okay. Oh, wow, where are we going to draw this? How about way at the bottom under where it says neurotransmitter? Can you draw it right down there? Okay. And then we'll have the little hooks here on this side.
At the bottom.
Okay. And this stuff right here is called myosin. It's green in the picture. Then we're going to have this disc holding on to the actin, which we can just draw as a curlicue like this. It's not that hard to draw, right? Like that. When the contraction takes place, these little hooks will grab that actin and pull those in to shorten it. You can see the little hooks right here on the green part, the heads they're called. And then remember I told you there were four proteins? So myosin and actin, that's the curlicue is actin. In order for those to be able to hook those in there, two other proteins have to be moved. All right, so we have these proteins, and those are called tropomyosin and troponin. They're sitting on top of the actin. That's this left picture over here. And what happens is I have to get something in here to grab those little red troponin, pull them out of the way, opening up the little place where the hook can grab hold of. So because we don't want that ability for that to hook on there all the time, otherwise we'd be clenched up all the time, right? We'd be contracted all the time. We don't want that. So we just want it to contract when I tell it to contract. So to do that, I have to move the troponin out of the way, and I do that by grabbing the tropomyosin and pulling on that like a little rope. It opens up a little keyhole, if you will. That little hook can fit in the keyhole and pull it. Okay? So what is the magic to open that up? An ion. So we're going to see that now in our video.
our bodies by contracting skeletal muscle. While the results of this action are plain to see, the mechanism behind the action is not. Contraction of skeletal muscle tissue occurs when actin and myosin myofilaments slide past one another, causing the sarcomere to shorten. It is important to note that the individual myofilaments do not change length themselves, but instead overlap each other to shorten the sarcomere. Moving in for a closer look, we can see the details of how this occurs. The molecules you see here are myosin, which at rest has both adenine diphosphate and phosphate molecules attached at the individual myosin heads, actin, tropomyosin, and troponin. When we decide to move, calcium is released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. These molecules bind with the troponin molecules. This causes the tropomyosin molecules to move, revealing myosin attachment sites on the actin myofilaments. The single phosphate attached to the myosin heads gets released as the heads move to connect with the attachment sites on the actin. The resulting formation is called a crossbridge. The remaining adenine diphosphate molecule is then expended in what is called a power stroke, when the myosin heads pull the actin inward. Once the adenine diphosphate attachment is spent, adenine triphosphate molecules attach themselves to the myosin heads. These molecules trigger the release of the myosin heads from the actin attachment sites and are immediately broken down into adenine diphosphate and a single phosphate as the heads move back into their resting position. This is called the recovery stroke. If calcium is still present, the cycle will repeat again, and the sarcomere will continue to shorten until the calcium ions are transported back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum and the muscle relaxes.
Functional unit is called the sarcomere. And that's, put a big star by that one. The sarcomere that looks like this. That right there. Okay, so now here are the steps in the mechanism. Yikes. That's what you're going to write in this big here. How muscle fibers contract, one cycle of a sarcomere contraction. What I need you to do with that box that has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 boxes, I need to draw a line right down the middle. And you're going to have 10 boxes to write in, okay? So I would recommend going down the left side for the first 5 and then down the right side for the second 5, okay? Here we go. First of all, energy is required in the form of what? We hear it.
ATP.
All right, so your very first box is going to say ATP needed. Number 2, the nerve sends a signal to the muscle. The nerve sends a signal to the muscle from the brain, and it says, we're fixing to move. We're going to move. Next, sarcoplasmic reticulum releases calcium into the sarcoplasm. Remember, that's the cytoplasm. Right there on that box, you can just say that's box number 3 down. So, Mari, you're just going to do it like that instead of on the side to side? That's fine. I'm just saying you're going to have 10 things. Okay? So if you draw a line down the middle, this can be in box number 3. Release of calcium. You can say release of calcium. Of course it's coming from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Remember, that's going to be releasing stuff, probably having been folded in the Golgi apparatus. It gets released into the sarcoplasm, which is the cytoplasm.
Wait, so it's ATP and then the third one's calcium?
ATP, nerve send signal, calcium released. And then calcium will bind to troponin. That's sitting around the actin. So I can use these other colors right here. Around the actin, I have troponin. Put this yellow, orange stuff on here. And then the purple one I'll put on there for the next one, which is called tropomyosin, which kind of goes a little bit like that, like a rope. Notice my calcium is a 2+ ion. Okay, next. tropomyosin, exposing the active sites. Okay, so this is going to be uncovering the keyhole. So that should be your first five boxes filled, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to have five boxes on the other side now to go to. So is it important to you, for you to know troponin and tropomyosin? The answer is yes. There's four things there you need to know. Myosin, actin, troponin, tropomyosin. They're all four working together. Next, the active sites can now bind to the myosin, forming a cross bridge. So active sites, active, cross bridge forms. ATP binds to the myosin, degrades to ADP. We call that the power stroke. You can just write down in there, power stroke. That's the grab and pull. All right, the myosin is grabbing and pulling, known as the power stroke. Then the ADP drops off to get recycled, and the new ATP binds to the myosin, releasing it. So it grabs it, it has to let go. That's called the return stroke. And our last one is the process begins over as long as there's enough calcium present. All right, so this is what is known as a cascade of biochemical events. These are some of the most difficult things we'll talk about in this classroom, these cascades of biochemical events. It's quite mechanical. Notice I'm just moving things around so I can grab things to move them around. That's mechanical. But these chemicals have to do what they're doing in order for that mechanics to take place. But this is called mechanism, a mechanism by which we can shorten that sarcomere.
So all this is to just make them do
this? Uh-huh, just to make them slide across each other like that. Which will, so let's say they were arm wrestling, okay, with somebody who's about the same strength as you, and you're gonna go back and forth, and that muscle's gonna be contracting, right? So that whole time where calcium's released, power stroke, return power. What happens after a while to your arm?
It gets tired.
It gets fatigued. And when that happens, we may run out of calcium. We may run out of ATP. That's typically what we're going to run out of is ATP. I don't have enough energy for this, and I let the other guy win, right? Boom. Wins the arm wrestling contest. All right, do we have these 10 things written down? Remember, try to figure out a way to shorten it. So you don't have to write every word. In college, they won't wait for you. But they will send you the lecture. They'll let you take it. I am recording this if anybody wants it. Just, you have to tell me. If you don't tell me, I won't send it.
So like on bodybuilders, when they always say that when they're in working muscle, it rips and then goes outside the spirit. So is this what's bridging?
We'll get to that, I believe, in Module 6, where it talks about the actual tissue. It's these are ripping. Yeah, they're ripping and growing back stronger. So, you know, and there's a couple reasons why your muscles hurt when you work on them. One of them is you are building them, but the other is you're running out of ATP. And we have to go to a different kind of energy production, and when we do that, we collect up a chemical inside our muscles, and it hurts. It's called lactic acid. All right, how we doing? We got our 10 blanks? Okay. All right, let's watch a little video.
You use muscles every day to do activities. This woman is using muscles to breathe, circulate blood, and move her hand to take notes. Your cardiac and smooth muscle tissues are involuntary. You do not consciously control their actions. Skeletal muscle works under voluntary control. Skeletal muscles are composed of bundles of muscle fibers. Muscle fibers are long cylindrical cells containing several nuclei. Muscles will contract or relax when they receive signals from the nervous system. A neuromuscular junction is the site of the signal exchange. This is where the synaptic bulb of an axon terminal and muscle fiber connect. Muscle fibers are composed of many myofibrils. A myofibril contains contractile units called sarcomeres. Sarcomeres run adjacent to one another down the length of the myofibril. Each sarcomere consists of alternating thick and thin protein filaments, giving skeletal muscle its striated appearance. The muscle contracts when these filaments slide past each other, The thick filaments are myosin, which are anchored at the center of the sarcomere, called the M line. The thin filaments are composed of the protein actin, which are anchored to the Z lines on the outer edges of the sarcomere. Because the actin filaments are anchored to the Z lines, the sarcomere shortens from both sides when actin filaments slide along the myosin filaments. Although the action between the filaments is described as sliding, the myosin filament actually pulls the actin along its length. The cross bridges of the myosin filaments attach to the actin filaments and exert force on them to move. This action is known as the sliding filament mechanism of muscle contraction. In this model, the sarcomeres shorten without the thick or thin filaments changing in length. A contraction begins when a bound ATP is hydrolyzed to ADP and inorganic phosphate. This causes the myosin head to extend and can attach to a binding site on actin, forming a cross bridge. An action called the power stroke is triggered, allowing myosin to pull the actin filament toward the M line, thereby shortening the sarcomere. ADP and inorganic phosphate are released during the power stroke. The myosin remains attached to actin until a new molecule of ATP binds, freeing the myosin to either go through another cycle of binding and more contraction, or remain unattached to allow the muscle to relax. Muscle contractions are controlled by the actions of calcium. The thin actin filaments are associated with regulatory proteins called troponin and tropomyosin. When the muscle is relaxed, tropomyosin blocks the cross-bridge binding sites on actin. When calcium ion levels are high enough and ATP is present, calcium ions bind to the troponin, which displaces tropomyosin, exposing the myosin binding sites on actin. This allows myosin to attach to a binding site on actin, forming a cross bridge. Calcium ions are stored in the sarcoplasmic reticulum and are released in response to signals from the nervous system to contract. Neurotransmitter molecules are released from a neuron and bind to receptors, which depolarizes the membrane of the muscle fiber. The electrical impulse travels down the T-tubules and opens calcium stores. Calcium ions flow to the myofibrils, where they trigger a muscle contraction. As the actin and myosin slide along each other, the entire sarcomere shortens as the Z lines draw closer to the M line. As the sarcomeres in myofibrils contract, the entire muscle fiber will shorten. When muscle fibers contract in unison, a muscle can produce enough force to move the body, allowing you to take notes.
All of that's going on in your hand as you're taking notes. Pretty cool.
I mean, and does that happen like immediately? Immediately calcium is released?
Pretty much, yeah. The only thing, the thing that keeps it from happening efficiently is if you run out of ATP. Okay, so can we run out of ATP? Sure, yeah. We'll talk about that in a minute when you go, like, say, jogging. If you, anybody run a marathon before?
Yeah.
Have you? You sore the next day? But you have to also prepare yourself for it, right? You have to train. You have to train to be able to run that. Okay, so here we are. Number one, the myosin cross bridge attaches to the actin myofilament. Number two, we have the ADP degrading, so the ATP means moving. Then I have a new ATP coming in to let go. So here's our return stroke. And then we can do it again as long as there's enough calcium to open up those little keyholes. Here we can see it going. Here comes our calcium. We're going to move that troponin and tropomyosin out of the way. Opening up that little spot, looks like a little white spot right there. They can grab a hold of it. ATP degrades to ADP. And then it recycles so I can have the return stroke. Does it not give me the return stroke? Oh, not quite. So that's not too bad, right? There's a lot of biochemistry going on right there. Okay. But so this brings up an interesting topic. What if it can't let go on our return stroke? Have you ever had a muscle cramp? It's not letting go. Okay, it's not letting go. There's also another,
Why do those hurt?
Because it's running out of ATP. So when it's running out of ATP, it's holding, holding.
It's
it runs, it gets really tired, it runs out of ATP, it starts using another mechanism which produces something called lactic acid, which is toxic. It builds up in your muscles and it hurts. Because not only will it hurt while it's happening, when it's over, it'll hurt. Because you didn't have enough ATP. All right, it also explains rigor mortis. Do y'all know what rigor mortis is? Okay. Y'all ever watched like a crime show where there's a dead body, right? There's a dead body.
Rigor mortis is after you die.
Yes, you die, and guess why? Guess why you have rigor mortis? Rigor mortis means your muscles are all contracted. And the reason is they do the they contract, and they don't have enough energy to let go. So they hold on. So they're holding on for a while, causing the body to be stiff like this. And a coroner will come in. Not usually the coroner. Who's the other guy? The doctor that comes in and looks at it. And they can see how much rigor mortis there is, and they can give an idea of how long the body's been dead. Okay, because guess what happens over some time? So it's going to hold on like this, hold. Well, over time, the muscle's going to just degrade away. So over time, it's just going to fall off. And therefore, if a long time goes by, there'll be no more rigor mortis. Okay? So right here, 2 to 6 hours, the rigor begins, and typically this is called rigor. The word mortis means dead. Rigor means stiff. So here, at 2 to 6 hours after death, the body becomes stiff. The stiffness moves all the way down the body. It begins with the eyelids, jaw muscles. After about 2 hours, and the center of the body begins to stiffen as well. So now between 2 and 6, we can estimate that. 12 hours, rigor mortis is complete. Peak rigor mortis at 12 hours. The entire body is rigid. At 15 to 36, we have a loss of rigor mortis. In the small muscles first, because they're the ones that are breaking down, because they're small. Rigor lost in the head and neck, and at last in the large leg muscles. And then 36 to 48, rigor totally disappears. The muscle tone now becomes relaxed, so now we can tell if the dead body, if it's still intact, it's older than, it's been dead longer than 48 hours, you see. Which is a little bit gruesome, but you see how useful it is, right? It's useful for cops to figure out how long a body's been dead. Yes?
I have a more gruesome question.
Okay.
If the body is not in a complete piece, is rigor mortis still going to happen or no?
If
or
it's not,
it
what do you mean by not in complete peace?
You're in a car crash and your arm gets cut off.
Oh, the arm gets cut off. Okay, yeah. So there's no ATP. If there's no ATP coming, it'll hold that muscle stiff. It'll hold that muscle stiff. For sure. Yes.
Like forever?
Not until it breaks down the muscle after 36 hours.
If your arm just got cut off, it would get stiff.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you're trying to take the arm in to reattach, right? You got to reattach and get blood supply. The blood supply will deliver the ATP. The ATP will allow the muscle to regain, as long as it's not damaged.
That happens to animals too, right?
Sure. Oh, yeah.
So is that why you? Sorry. Is that why you like if a limb, like if there's a separate limb, you want to keep it cold because that'll keep that going?
Exactly. It'll slow down the chemical processes in there, right? And therefore, when that's slowed down, I can go sew it back together, and hopefully, yeah. All right. There's our gruesome part for the day. All right, now the neuromuscular junction, you have a box for that, yes? Neuro meaning nerve, muscular meaning muscle. There's a junction in between them where the nerve touches the muscle. And that little junction is called a synapse. All right, nerves and neurons carry a control muscle contraction. These special nerves are called motor neurons. They touch muscles, motor meaning movement. Where the neuron touches the muscle, a special junction is created called a synapse. The nerve sends a signal across a synaptic gap via something known as a neurotransmitter. It's a chemical. And in our muscles, that neurotransmitter chemical is called acetylcholine. Acetylcholine, which we are going to shorten down to ACH. So our neurotransmitter, you have a blank for neurotransmitter? You're going to write ACH. It's a chemical. It comes from the nerve. It's released across the synaptic gap. A nervous signal becomes a chemical signal called acetylcholine, and the muscle responds by contracting. Another chemical called acetylcholinesterase is the chemical that says stop producing acetylcholine. And it breaks it down. It breaks down acetylcholine. All of this requires ATP. If there's no ATP, the return stroke is stopped, causing the muscle to cramp up. So that's typically why your muscles are sore, you're running out of ATP. All right, so that is once again a kind of a biochemical cascade here that takes place. What do I want you to do? I want you to draw this synapse. Okay, so this is the muscle here on the bottom. And this bulb thing coming in, that's the neuron. And that neuron is coming, and notice how it's not actually touching the muscle. It's getting really close to it. All right, so there's a little gap in between the synapse and the muscle, and that gap is called the synaptic gap, sometimes called the synaptic cleft. And you're supposed to draw this where?
I don't know, I'm just using the box.
Oh, it's a very skinny box there. Sketch the neurotransmitter junction and skeletal muscle. So write the word synapse, which you have synapse down here as well. So the neuron is the nerve cell from the brain, the nervous tissue. The synapse is where it touches or nearly touches the muscle. And the neurotransmitter is acetylcholine. All right, so what happens down here is that we have a signal traveling down the neuron. It's called an action potential, which we will talk about when we get to the nervous system. And it's sending it down right here. And as it breaks through the end of the axon, it turns into a chemical. Goes from an electrical signal to a chemical signal. That chemical is acetylcholine, which crosses over the gap into the muscle, and as it gets into the muscle, it'll cause the muscle to release calcium. And we know what happens after that. The muscle could contract. Keep in mind that synapses also happen from nerve to nerve. When we get to the nervous system, we'll get back to synapses, but this one, this is called a motor neuron because it's touching a muscle. Remember the two types of tissue that can be have electric flow through them, electricity flow through them, are nervous tissue and muscular tissue. We'll get to a minute here where we're talking about our motor unit, and you'll draw something again on that. Notice there's a mitochondria. There's going to be a whole lot of mitochondria down here. Guess what this process requires? Lots of?
Energy.
In the form of?
ATP.
ATP is made in the mitochondria, right? So there's another important word, synapse. And a synaptic cleft or a synaptic gap in between. Comes really close. All right, everybody have a little drawing there of your little synapse? Yeah? Okay. Here's another picture showing it, where it comes really close, see, and it's going to turn these, the mitochondria is going to use electricity to turn these electrical signal into acetylcholine. There's a receptor on the muscle for ACH. Okay, so here I have neuron functional unit of the nervous system, if you want to use the words that we're using for your book right here. Synapse, the interface between neuron and another cell, muscle, or neuron, but in this case we're looking at a motor neuron. And the neurotransmitter is a chemical release by the neuron allowing for communication. Those are the official definitions. If you already had something else in there that you understand better, that's fine. This was the last thing on part A, yeah? Contraction, right? We see an arm contracting, the muscle contracting, and then it can also, remember, it requires energy to release it too, the return stroke, to release it. And right here, I think we have a video. It's very poor audio, sorry.
Action potentials arriving at the presynaptic terminal cause voltage-gated calcium ion channels to open. Calcium ions diffuse into the cell and cause synaptic vesicles to release acetylcholine, a neurotransmitter molecule. Acetylcholine molecules diffuse from the presynaptic terminal across the synaptic cleft and bind to the receptor sites on the ligand-gated sodium ion channels. This causes the ligand-gated sodium ion channels to open and sodium ions diffuse into the cell, making the membrane potential more positive. If the membrane potential reaches threshold level, an action potential will be produced.
Okay, that is actually showing a synaptic cleft of another neuron. So notice for the neurons, I need calcium and sodium. And we're going to find out eventually in potassium, called the calcium and potassium pump. All right, now we're in part B. Turn your pages over to part B. Hooray, the biochemistry, yay. So I'll tell you now to just relax. Relax those muscles. The action potential has to stop. The nerves telling your muscle to contract have to stop. Otherwise, you're in rigor mortis. And when rigor mortis is when the action potential won't stop because they don't have a signal telling them to stop. Okay? All right. So the release of the acetylcholine must stop, and it's acetylcholinesterase that stops it. Notice how I have a little short ACH for acetylcholine, but I don't have anything short for acetylcholinesterase. That's just a big old giant word. So acetyl.
Is this what we write?
I think I might have the L in the wrong place now. Do I? Acetyl?
T?
Is it
L-Y-L?
Y-L?
It's Y.
L-Y.
It is L-Y?
Yeah.
C. Acetylcholinesterase. It'll break down acetylcholine. Okay, so then the calcium will go back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, allowing for the muscle to relax.
I think it's Y.
You think I have the L and the Y out of order?
Because the other way you spelled it.
You should switch
the Y. I think I should switch the Y L. I think I misspelled that word.
Oh, you misspelled it on the thing?
Yes, I think I did. I just mixed those two letters around, I think.
Wait,
I said to, it seems like the Y should come before the L.
Yes.
All right, y'all can just check me on that in the book. Okay. Okay, so here we have a motor unit. Okay, so I'm trying to recruit. It's called recruiting. You need something on this other slide?
Oh,
no,
this
is
what
you're on.
This is how muscles are lax.
Yeah.
Oh.
How they relax by acetylcholinesterase stopping acetylcholine.
Are we burning?
Breaking down acetylcholine.
Oh my gosh, it's too much.
How muscles relax? The ACH connection. Acetylcholinesterase, which I'll change the spelling right here. It's just a YL instead of a LY. That looks better. Causes acetylcholine to break down, causing it not to have the thing that makes the myosin heads graph, okay? Calcium goes back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So here, what is important? Acetylcholinesterase stops ACH. That's all you have to write for that. All right. So if I want a muscle to do something, I have to convince it to move by putting in the calcium, the acetylcholine, all of it has to be there for the muscle to move. When I get my muscle to move, that is called recruiting it. I'm going to recruit the muscle. And then, of course, I have to let it has to come to a point where it can also relax so that I can maybe recruit it again. What if I'm doing, what are these called, pearls? You know, like you're doing this, you go recruit, release, relax, recruit, relax. This kind of thing, okay? So, and we're telling it to do that. And as long as I have enough calcium, enough ATP, and enough acetylcholine, which I should, then it'll do that for you until you get tired. Okay, so depending on the actual muscle that's being recruited, we might have lots of nerves making it recruit. Think about it. What would you say, who does, what, do guys, do y'all do weightlifting for football? You don't?
No.
Y'all have a shack thingy and everything.
A shed?
Wow, okay. Wait. So if y'all were gonna guess, what is the muscle in your body that's able to really lift a lot of weight?
Your thighs.
Right here on your leg, right? That especially, you know, what's that called? What's that called?
Hamstring.
When you push it, is that a?
Leg press.
Leg press.
Yeah.
Leg press. We can look really strong with the leg press, right? Because
mm-hmm.
we can push a lot of weight with that.
Yeah.
Now, when you're doing this, guys, you can do pretty well. Girls, sorry. We just don't have as much here. You know, there's that machine that you have a weight back there. It's like universal weight system back there. And you push it up like this. So I used to do that with no weight attached to it. None. So just the bar was a lot for me to push up. That's because female upper body strength is not as strong as male upper body strength. That's all there is to it. Period. Sorry, I didn't make the rule. God did it that way. Okay, so men have better upper body strength. It's all about testosterone. It does that. Okay, so depending on the muscle I want to recruit, I'm going to have a motor neuron that'll innervate it for motion. If it's large, all these muscles here are called the quadriceps. That means there's four different muscles in there, quad. Then I'm going to have a lot. I'm going to have a large motor unit to really recruit it and make it very, very powerful. Okay, so I could have 1,000 branches for one of these little nerves coming down there to give it a lot of power. Now, it's mostly power without precision. But if I have a small motor unit and I want precision, I want you now to think about your eyes. You don't even think about the fact that we move our eyes around a lot. We're looking here, we're looking up, we're looking over there, we're looking far, we're looking. All of that takes muscle, and they're very, very small motor units because it takes precision. I also like to talk about the hands. Who plays piano? Anybody play piano? Okay, this requires precision. Okay,
muscle memory. A lot of muscle memory.
Yeah, that too. We're going to talk about muscle memory next time. Okay, so we're going to have smaller motor units to get this finesse. So we have power and we have finesse. All right, it has to do with how many nerves are touching it. It also, like the muscles around your eye, you can imagine, I don't have giant bulges coming out of here with muscles, right? My muscles are not very big around my eye, but they're very good at making my eyes look around. Yeah? Okay. There's even muscles that make your pupil contract like that. That's a muscle, too, called the ciliary muscle. All right, this is what you're drawing in the box that says motor unit. Draw that little picture right there. You gotta
put this
type. Yeah, you can put the, if you want to put the smiley faces in, you can. You're going to have your neuron coming down, touching the muscle, and it can have as many little attachments or synapses as you want. What now? Attachments. It is an axon. This is called the dendrite and the axon. We'll get to that cell in the nervous system. It's called a neuron. Nerve cell. Peripheral nervous system. So y'all are drawing this in the box that says motor unit. I put this one in because it was easier to draw. Instead of those previous ones that showed all that action going on. If you don't have it yet, take a picture of it with your phone, because I have to move on. At the end, if you need me to come back to a slide, I can come back to a slide. But I have to move on, otherwise we're going to run out of time. So when you have a nervous stimulus to make that muscle go like that, okay, we're going to flex our, this is called the biceps, you know that, but it's not just the biceps, it's the biceps brachii. Turns out there's a biceps in your leg too. All right, so we have to be more specific. Biceps brachii is going to contract. Okay, it's the all or none rule. The muscle is either going to contract or it's not. Does it have enough calcium? Does it have enough ATP? Does it have enough ACH? Then it will contract. The strength of contraction, in other words, if I'm picking up something very big or I'm picking up something very small, that's not based in the strength of the contraction itself, it's based in the frequency of the contraction. So if I need to have lift something really heavy, I need more signal to send more of that there, okay? Not a stronger, you can see that sliding filament model, the only thing that's gonna make the difference between it being strong or not strong is how many times it does it and how quickly it does it. If it's slow, then it's gonna be small. If it's fast, and a lot of it's going to be strong, okay? When a motor unit contracts, it's called, it's being recruited. Now, do y'all have like a table coming up here?
No.
All right, here it is, gang. Here's our stimulus, threshold, submaximal, maximal, supramaximal. And this is the result you're writing over there. Muscle stimulus. Threshold, it's already written for you. Strong enough to create one action potential. That's what you're writing next to threshold. Submaximal, increasing streak, more ATP. More AP. AP means action potential. Action potential just means signal. Signal. Along more neurons. Maximal stimulus strong enough to create action potential in all motor neurons in the whole muscle, and the supramaximal, more stimuli, but no more effect. In other words, higher frequency, more, faster. Frequency, more of them. That's gonna keep it recruited over and over again for your lifting weights or whatever you're doing. Who knew that muscles were so complex?
Gosh.
Can you see those letters well enough? I know they're in white print.
Mm-hmm.
I could have turned them into bold, I suppose.
Do you do the editing like every week?
Of my presentations?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you make these yourself?
Mm-hmm.
Or do you?
And I make them for the rest of the ODA.
You do?
Mm-hmm. Depending on which subject matter.
Mm-hmm.
All of general, all of this one. Half of biology. I'm just glad you don't have to write down these words too. All this is really saying is that you have to have enough of the neuron action for the muscle to contract. That's all it's saying. Because it's either going to happen or it's not. We're going to see that again on our nerves. And the example they use in the book is flushing the toilet. Once you flush the toilet, you can't stop it from flushing, right? So it's all or none. If your toilet's not working right, it's none. If it does, it goes. You can't stop it. Same thing here. But they'll explain that in our nervous tissue. All right, I'm gonna have to move. Are we good?
Mm-hmm.
I can go back at the end. All right, so muscle tone. When we're awake, we have muscle tone. Some muscles are recruited, others are not. They're kind of going back and forth. I'm standing up, I'm using more muscles than you are sitting down, but even sitting down, you're using muscles. Otherwise, you would just flop over in your chair. Yeah, we don't want to do that during class, please. But when you're asleep, there's much less muscle tone, but there is still some muscle tone going on. All right? If there's no nerve contact at all, the muscles will suffer a condition called atrophy, which, and that's a word you're defining in your book right there. Atrophy means when the muscle cells shrink away due to lack of use. You may know somebody who is paralyzed. If you know somebody who's paralyzed, you notice how their muscles just get real skinny because they're not using them. You have to use your muscles to keep them in shape, if you will. Also, I have a picture of a baby over here. Have y'all ever held a baby? Let's say a 6-month-old baby, one that can kind of hold up its head by itself. And if it's awake, it's like this. But when that baby falls asleep, boy, they feel heavier, don't they? That's because their muscle tone is like this, and you're just having to really support every bit of it. When they're awake, they're supporting some of themselves with their muscle tone, and you don't have to support all of that. A brand new baby can't do any of that. Therefore, you have to hold all of it. But brand new babies typically aren't that heavy. They're pretty lightweight. But that's why I'm showing a baby right over there for muscle tone. Okay, where do we get all the energy for this, y'all?
ATP.
Here it is. Don't forget that. We must have ATP. Let's look at ATP a little more closely. What is the magic of ATP? What is it about? It stands for adenosine triphosphate. Adenosine is like an amino acid. And then tri means three. And we're going to see here, it's got three. It's got a sugar, so adenine is our amino acid. We have a ribose on here, which is a sugar. And then we have our phosphate atoms hanging off the end. That little red line in between them stands for a high energy bond. So it's kind of like a spring. Anybody here take biology one with me, Cammie? You did. Remember that little gun with the ATP gun we made with the spring and we shot it off?
Yeah.
That little spring. So imagine a spring on there, and when you let it go, boing, it flies off. So in other words, that spring gives it some extra oomph to go flying. That's what's happening here. Typically what happens is that the ATP will degrade to ADP, adenosine diphosphate, getting rid of that phosphate and having that energy come from that bond. Can the ADP degrade to just one phosphate? It can, but typically if things are going right in your body, they're going to actually attach that third phosphate on there and allow it to be the ATP degrading to ADP. All right, this is called cellular respiration. Breaks down ADP to provide general energy to cell. The byproducts are carbon dioxide and water. If you remember from chemistry, those of you who took chemistry, that's a combustion reaction. So in our bodies we have a very gentle combustion rate. What do you think about when you hear combustion? Fire. A fire's
Oh,
combustion. Okay, so we have a gentle combustion reaction going on in our body. That's why you have a temperature. Not a fever, hopefully. But a temperature. 98.6, right? Because we have combustion going on
so
here.
So then what causes your temperature to go up to have a fever?
And so you have your body is responding to a stress, and that stress usually is bacterial infection. Fever's your friend. We'll actually get to that when we talk about the immune system. People think, oh, fever's bad. No. Fever's really good. Unless it gets too high, it starts to kill cells off. But it kills off bacteria they're invading. That's what it's there for. God put it there on purpose. So fever's our friend. All right, so we're going to watch a little, just a very small animation of our phosphate getting kicked off right here. It goes a little faster than I would hope, so you got to watch it kind of closely. Are we ready? Here it goes. We're going to have our phosphate added on. There it goes, and it's going to break, and there it is. The energy comes off of it. This all stays the same, notice. Added on, ATP, kicked off, ADP. All right, so our respiration, our body is all about getting that adenosine diphosphate back to adenosine triphosphate so the energy broken with that bond release can make our muscles move. All right, so these are the three types of ATP production. You have a box of three things here. Number one, aerobic. What do you think about when you hear aerobic? When you're doing aerobic exercises, what are you doing? What is it? But what is it doing for? Why is running aerobic and sit-ups or not?
Because when you're running, your muscles
you use more muscles.
No, it's not that. I just learned it yesterday.
Okay. When you're running, what else happens to your body?
You sweat.
Yeah. What else?
It's a lot of.
You get tired.
What happens to your heart?
It beats faster.
What happens to your breathing rate?
It goes faster.
That's aerobic. You're breathing more. It happens automatically, right? When you're running. You automatically, your heart rate goes higher and your breathing rate goes higher because you're trying to replace that oxygen. So it's a long process where glucose combined with oxygen produces, this is important. Do you have the word aerobic respiration written down?
Nope.
Or do you have to write it?
No.
Okay, you have three boxes. One of the boxes is on the other page. So box number one, say aerobic respiration, 36 ATP.
There's
a box at the top right there.
That was from what is ATP?
So that's ATP.
Yeah.
What is ATP?
Oh, that's what is
ATP.
And
the next one is ATP.
Okay, I'm sorry. I just know the three boxes one went to the other side. Okay, so types of ATP production. Aerobic produces 36 ATPs. That's what I want from you right there, y'all. Do you understand aerobic means you have oxygen in there? You're breathing. This is why we have to breathe, in fact. To get that respiration to work. Number two, creatine phosphate reserve. In our bodies, we have this stuff called creatine phosphate. You ever heard of that? Some bodybuilders drink creatine, right?
Powder.
Yeah, they put it in their drink or whatever. They make their smoothie out of it or whatever. And it's really, really fast to produce quick energy, but it only makes one ATP. So my regular aerobic regimen makes 36 ATPs. That's a lot, y'all. Creatine, in a pinch, I've run out of ATP. My creatine reserve will make one in a bunch of muscles, right? And then I have anaerobic, that means no air. I've run out of air, and that makes two. So what I want you to know about this, aerobic respiration produces 36 ATP. Creatine phosphate reserve produces one ATP. Anaerobic respiration produces two ATPs. So which one is obviously the most efficient? Aerobic rest. So keep breathing is what I'm going to tell you. Keep breathing. Now, down here in anaerobic, it's pretty fast, but it's very short term. No oxygen is needed for this, but one glucose yields only two ATPs. Up here, one glucose yields 36. That's a lot. And then it creates a toxic byproduct called lactic acid. Lactic acid is toxic. It sits in your muscles for a while, and it causes your muscles to be sore. That's why your muscles are sore the day after a race. You had oxygen debt. You didn't breathe enough. It's not like you could have, but training will train your lungs to open up and breathe more and get more oxygen exchange going on there. So that's why training is important. Also, we'll talk about in a minute, stretching your muscles, getting your muscles, don't overtax them by not getting them ready to go on this. So we just have three things. Aerobic, 36, Creatine phosphate, one. Anaerobic,
so anaerobic
two.
Is like when you run a race or something.
Whenever you run out of ATP, no matter what. You don't have to be running a race. If your hand is hurting right now, you might have run out of ATP in your hand muscles. Okay? It's possible. If you're sore tomorrow, you'll know for sure, because there's lactic acid buildup in there. Okay, so ATP breaks down to ADP plus phosphate plus that energy that we use to move our muscles. So lactic acid buildup, muscles cramp due to a lack of oxygen. Anaerobic respiration results in lactic acid production. It's a byproduct. It's a toxic byproduct. Okay, and muscles cramp and they will hurt the next day. All right, you need to go back?
Can you go back one second?
It's probably this one. This one?
Mm-hmm.
This one?
Yes.
No.
Remember, ADP just stands for adenosine diphosphate. It's only got two.
You're lifting weights. The first time feels easy, but each lift takes more and more effort until you can't continue. Inside your arms, the muscles responsible for the lifting have become unable to contract. Why do our muscles get fatigued? We often blame lactic acid or running out of energy, but these factors alone don't account for muscle fatigue. There's another major contributor, the muscle's ability to respond to signals from the brain. To understand the roots of muscle fatigue, it helps to know how a muscle contracts in response to a signal from a nerve. These signals travel from the brain to the muscles in a fraction of a second via long, thin cells called motor neurons. The motor neuron and the muscle cell are separated by a tiny gap, and the exchange of particles across this gap enables the contraction. On one side of the gap, the motor neuron contains a neurotransmitter called acetylcholine. On the other side, charged particles, or ions, line the muscle cell's membrane, potassium on the inside and sodium on the outside. In response to a signal from the brain, the motor neuron releases acetylcholine, which triggers pores on the muscle cell membrane to open. Sodium flows in and potassium flows out. The flux of these charged particles is a crucial step for muscle contraction. The change in charge creates an electrical signal called an action potential that spreads through the muscle cell, stimulating the release of calcium that's stored inside it. This flood of calcium causes the muscle to contract by enabling proteins buried in the muscle fibers to lock together and ratchet towards each other, pulling the muscle tight. The energy used to power the contraction comes from a molecule called ATP. ATP also helps pump the ions back across the membrane afterward, resetting the balance of sodium and potassium on either side. This whole process repeats every time a muscle contracts. With each contraction, energy in the form of ATP gets used up. Waste products like lactic acid are generated, and some ions drift away from the muscle's cell membrane, leaving a smaller and smaller group behind. Though muscle cells use up ATP as they contract repeatedly, they are always making more. So most of the time, even heavily fatigued muscles still have not depleted this energy source. And though many waste products are acidic, fatigued muscles still maintain pH within normal limits, indicating that the tissue is effectively clearing these wastes. But eventually, over the course of repeated contractions, there may not be sufficient concentrations of potassium, sodium, or calcium ions immediately available near the muscle cell membrane to reset the system properly. So even if the brain sends a signal, the muscle cell can't generate the action potential necessary to contract. Even when ions like sodium, potassium, or calcium are depleted in or around the muscle cell, these ions are plentiful elsewhere in the body. With a little time, they will flow back to the areas where they're needed, sometimes with the help of active sodium and potassium pumps. So if you pause and rest, muscle fatigue will subside as these ions replenish throughout the muscle. The more regularly you exercise, the longer it takes for muscle fatigue to set in each time. That's because the stronger you are, the fewer times this cycle of nerve signal from the brain to contraction in the muscle has to be repeated to lift a certain amount of weight. Fewer cycles means slower ion depletion. So as your physical fitness improves, you can exercise for longer at the same intensity. Many muscles grow with exercise, and larger muscles also have bigger stores of ATP and a higher capacity to clear waste, pushing fatigue even farther into the future. Now find out.
All right. So if you're going to run a marathon, you want to have you want to load up. We used to call it carb loading. You want to load up on the kind of foods that is going to give you enough ATP. Furthermore, you do want to have your muscles ready for this by getting them training and stretching. Okay. So here are some apparently what some runners eat the day before the race: sweet potatoes, bananas. That has a lot of potassium. Oatmeal, very nutrient dense. Rice. I don't have on here pasta. A lot of people eat pasta.
Is that
There's a lot
why?
Of carbs on there.
Because I used to go to like races and they would always give out bananas and oatmeal.
At a where?
At races.
What kind? Oh, like where you're
like,
running?
Yeah.
Like a running race? Yeah. Yeah. Because the potassium, that potassium needs to go across there. We don't typically have a problem with sodium in our bodies because we get enough sodium, especially in America, because it comes from salt. And we use that. But potassium, we need to do that. If you're having a lot of muscle cramping, supposedly eating bananas will also help because they're high in potassium. We'll talk about that sodium-potassium pump when we talk about the nervous system. All right, these are just showing people getting ready to go on a race. It's ready to getting those muscles nice and stretched out. You're kind of warming them up, stretching them out. It's important. Guys who play football, you know this, right? You need to always stretch out before a game, right? If you don't, you're going to pull on that muscle beyond its ability to be pulled, and that will cause little tears, which, of course, will eventually build up your muscle to be stronger. But if you're sore for the game, then you might not be as helpful for the game. All right, did you get every blank filled in? Every blank is done? All right, then we're done here with the lecture. Does anybody need me to go back? Yeah.